My name's Tom Pinto. I'm a principal project leader here at TWI, working in the electron beam section. Hopefully you're here today because you think this is the EBManPower demo day. If not, now is the opportunity to slope off the Zoom or out of the room. So just to give you a little bit of a heads up, the people on Zoom, you will have realized that the meeting is being recorded. Those in the room, this is a heads up. So in terms of advice, really, if you've got a phone, please switch it on to silent if you do need to take calls, because otherwise the guys on the Zoom are going to get a load of background noise. Equally, as you can see there, we're not expecting a fire drill. So if the fire alarm does go off, we're going to be going out the doors on my right and then out the fire escape on the right, unless that is blocked. But follow myself or someone else with a TWI lanyard on, we should know where we're going. Again, from a face mask perspective, we've all got fairly familiar with wearing these. It's up to you whether you want to wear one in the room. My asthma's flared up, so I am coughing quite a bit. It is kind of COVID negative, so I'm going to keep my mask on today so as I don't share my kind of cough with everyone. But again, when we're outside of the meeting room, there is a requirement to wear a face mask when you're around about site. Again, we're going to encourage, obviously, questions from people on Zoom. For them to be able to hear that, we ask that you use the microphone that's going to be passed around for questions. So please be aware that otherwise people on Zoom aren't going to hear the questions at all. For those on the Zoom, the only bit of Q&A from my perspective is please use the kind of Q&A function. We'll collate the questions and then use them. But overall, the main idea of today is, as I say, to kind of find out what we did as a project, to ask questions. And you know, from my perspective, hopefully it'll be a fairly informal day, but hopefully quite an informative one at the same time. So in terms of where we are on the agenda, hopefully everyone's suitably watered and fed. Again, for those of you in the meeting room, hopefully you saw the kind of toilets out between us and the refreshments. In terms of the batting order for today, I'm obviously giving a brief introduction to the day. Then we're going to have the project video, which again gives an overview on what was done in the project. Then we drill down into a presentation from Jamie, where he's going to give an overview of Cammell Laird and their involvement as lead partner in the project. Then we're going to move, hopefully quite seamlessly, into a presentation from John Eldridge, who's going to be talking from almost a kind of end user or application kind of viewpoint. So that's going to be good. And then Chris Punchin and I are going to do a little bit of a double act presenting the EBManPower project itself. He's going to do the bulk of it. And then there's a little section where I talk about the weld development and qualification that TWI performed. Then there's going to be a large kind of Q&A session. But if there are questions as we go along in the day, please feel free to ask them. Don't kind of feel you have to store them up, but that's a place for us to have a Q&A. And then the thing that probably most people are here for is to actually look and see what was welded. So we're going to go out onto the service yard apron and have a look at that. And then once the meeting's formally concluded here at TWI, there's an opportunity to go over to CVE and see the Ebflow system there and have a tour as well. And so you're going to have to make your own way there. Hopefully, at the end of my presentation, I've got directions and I've also got a postcode if you haven't been there before. So I just thought I'd do a few slides on an overview of TWI. Hopefully, most of you are familiar with TWI. Obviously, we're a membership-based organisation. We've existed for 75 years now, started in 1946. And effectively, the benefit of being a membership-based organisation is that we are here to serve our members. And we work globally across 5 sites in the UK and 11 globally. And in terms of what we do, you can see the mission statement behind me. I'm not going to kind of read the slides verbatim, but we work across effectively 4 kind of different areas. There's materials, structural integrity, there's advanced manufacturing technologies, there is the structural integrity and the NDT. And then in terms of how that breaks down, again, there's various different kind of technologies that sit underneath that. You can see where I sit within the electron beam processes kind of section within that global world. But again, if you're interested any in those wider areas of what TWI does, please come and find me at the end and we can discuss that more if appropriate. So this is just a little bit of a flavour of kind of TWI in terms of kind of turnover, what kind of projects we get involved in. So the EB Manpower project made up part of that collaborative research programme kind of money, and obviously that ran from 2018 till, it's ending at the end of this month. So I thought it was useful just to give a very quick kind of slide overview really on the history of kind of reduced pressure work and the technology development that TWI has done over the years. And you can see the history dating back from the 1970s initially, where TWI were quite involved in high power welding. So that was mainly in chamber and then looking at working on kind of reduced pressure and the enabling technology to achieve that. And then you can see some of the subsequent projects where we've worked closely with people like CVE, and we've kind of licensed the work that we've done and some of the technology. And then you can see that blue kind of icon there, where you've got the EB Manpower project and some of the sister projects. I know one of the sister projects is here as well, in terms of kind of the work that Forge Masters are doing on their NIP project as well. So this slide again just gives a little bit of a background. I don't know how many people are familiar with basically reduced pressure EB welding, how it works, but the enabling technology of a reduced pressure EB gun, where what we do is we generate a vacuum against the part, and you can either have a traveling seal or a static seal, as you'll see on the right hand side there. But fundamentally, the key thing is being able to generate an electron beam that is effectively happy with being in quite a coarse vacuum, because electron beams generally prefer to be in quite a high vacuum environment. So being able to process things in a kind of millibar or kind of -1, -2 millibar coarse vacuum is pretty important. So again, that was some of the work that TWI had done pre my time at TWI. We're talking probably 80s and 90s when that was first done. So again, just setting the scene that most people who are familiar with electron beams are familiar with in-chamber welding. So you can see the progression all the way from very small kind of benchtop sized machines, which TWI generally doesn't have, up to much kind of larger scale chambers. But then there comes a point when actually even some of the large scale chambers are a bit of a limitation on processing parts. So that's where you then look to take a local vacuum, and you can see there whether you're welding in vacuum, in air, but predominantly the key thing for the Ebflow system is that bottom right, where we're welding out of a vacuum chamber, but with a vacuum within the gun and on the part itself. So that is, as I say, a bit of a whistle-stop tour, a bit of an introduction to TWI. I've managed to get through without coughing, which is good. So my asthma at the moment hasn't flared up too much. But really what we're kind of going to look at today is what was achieved within the project, but also setting the scene on some of the work of the partners and, let's say, the end user. So you'll see that in the partner presentations, firstly from Cammell Laird, then from John Eldridge at Urenco and U-Battery. Then, let's say, Chris and I doing a double act on the EB Manpower project itself. So that concludes what I was hoping to do in terms of an introduction. I don't know if there are any questions at this stage, or we can move on to kind of Jamie's presentation. If there aren't any questions, I don't know if there's anything on the Zoom. I'm just looking at a colleague of mine, no questions. So I'll hopefully switch us over to Jamie's presentation from Cammell Laird.
Let me just make sure my microphone's on. Okay, Right, so let me start by introducing myself. Thank you very much, Tom. My name is Jamie Wilgrass. I'm the Energy Project Manager at Cammell Laird, and I've been involved in managing our energy portfolio, one of which is the electron beam manpower, and that's what I'm going to take you through today. But essentially, I want to give you kind of an overview of Cammell Laird, what we do, what we work in, and a bit about our facility in Birkenhead. Okay, so hopefully this works. Maybe I'll... Tom, oh, I need to use that one. Do you want to? Always a bit of technical difficulty, isn't there? How about I give you a nod every time I want to just change the slide, if that works?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. All right, next slide, please. All right, so a bit of history about Cammell Laird. So Cammell Laird was actually founded in 1820. And it's been going ever since. There's been multiple different iterations of Cammell Laird over the years, but essentially we've been still going. So what you can see in this picture is actually the Ark Royal, which was one of the first ever bespoke made aircraft carriers. And during World War II, we were actually building a warship every single, every 21 days. Next slide, please. And then I want to give you a little bit of an overview of our facility here in Cammell Laird. So at the very bottom, you can see the River Mersey. And you can see a number of different dry docks, plus our large manufacturing facility in the top left, which is the construction hall. And then you've got a number of different bays. So what you can normally do in a process, which I'm going to take you through in a bit more detail with a schematic later on, but it's going to show you a bit of these facilities. So instead of actually taking you on a tour, we've done a tour recently for the YGN. And what we did was we went around and took a few videos of different bits. So we'll take you firstly through the construction hall, then show you the wet basin, which is this area in the middle. And then we'll show you a dry dock, which is one of the four that you have here. And then we'll show you a view from the slipway as well. So next slide, please. And press it again. So we're actually now walking into those massive doors on the construction hall. Because of the commercially sensitive information that we have in there, what we're trying to do is actually not record anything, but just show you the scale of the building. You've got your large cranes, you've got your large units, and it's split into two areas. You have on the lower side where you construct the modules, and then you've got a slope, which then as you build the modules together, you bring them up and you assemble them, and they go all the way down to the River Mersey, okay? So that's pretty much a view of that. If you go to the next slide, please. This is one of the dry docks. So for the dry dock, what you do is you have access to the underside of the ship. So they get put on blocks, all the water gets pumped out, and then you're able to work on it if any work needs to be done. This is actually a rare bit of footage of it actually being flooded again. So what they're doing is you're pumping the water back in, slowly raising it off these blocks, floating it, opening the door, and then the ship can then come out of the dry dock. Next slide, please. This is the facility in which the electron beam manpower project was put in. So this is the dished end. You have the dished end welded to the intermediate ring. This is a carbon steel flange, which was also welded to an intermediate ring. But you can kind of see around the facility now. It's a real industrial working shipyard. And you kind of want to prove that this technology will work in a heavy industry like this. Next slide, please. Right, this is a view of the slipway. As you can see, we've got, this is the construction hall behind you. You're looking down onto the River Mersey, and you can just see Liverpool in the background, but the ease of access we have to the river, okay? The River Mersey actually has a 10 meter difference between high tide and low tide. So that gives you a lot of time where you have to get ships in and out. Okay, next slide, please. I like the repetition as well. And then this is just one of the empty dry docks. You can see here, you've got a number of different blocks set up. So those blocks need to be put in the exact right position so that they're on the strength members of the ship. So if they're in the wrong place, the ship could end up puncturing its hull, and then you end up having a very expensive mistake. You know, this is still all done using standard, just a dock master who stands at the end of the dock. He will then have his guys on the ropes, making sure they have it aligned just right before they pump the water out, okay? Next slide, please. This is the wet basin. So the wet basin is after the ships have been constructed. They get brought in here at high tide, the gates open, then they're floated alongside where they are outfitted. So everything else gets put on board, really. But you can see the kind of scale of this facility that we do have here. That's one of the RFA ships. And then you've got the RC Pioneer, which is a jack-up rig. So these jack-up rigs are now being used to maintain wind farms now rather than oil rigs, which is what their initial purpose was. All right, next slide, please. And as I said before, I wanted to kind of show you about how our supply chain works, but also about how the material comes through the yard and we actually build ships. So the image on the left just shows the scale of the supply chain that we do have. Okay, it's from all around the UK and Northern Ireland. Then this is a schematic of our actual site at Cammell Laird. So what you'll have is your raw materials will come into the yard, then they'll get fabricated, they'll go into the construction hall where they get assembled into modules. They'll come to the far side and you'll slowly build your ship and it'll extrude out of the construction hall to where they become launched into the river, into the wet basin and alongside for outfitting. And then they'll go into the dry docks where the underside, any other work needs to be done, maybe paint the underside of the ship, make sure it's all ready to go. And then it will leave the dock and then down the River Mersey and out for final sea trials. All right, next slide, please. So our core projects and core things we work in really. So defense new build, which is fabrication of modules for shipbuilding submarines. We've got commercial marine. So commercial marine is anything from ferries, ship repair, ship building. Commercial new build is for, as you can see there, the Sir David Attenborough. Then you've got defense stuff. So this defense stuff is more like any kind of improvements, any kind of issues with ships. So it's like we have contracts with the RFA, contracts with the Type 45. And then finally, you've the energy sector. So the energy sector is what we're trying to build on is all our knowledge from these different areas and put it into energy, into nuclear. So we're taking the module build technology and we're trying to bring that together with our heavy manufacturing to try and fabricate such vessels as you have here. So yeah, that's pretty much that. And then next slide, please. This is kind of my roundup slide at the very end. It's kind of showing you that, you know, we have fabricated the pressure vessel, which Chris and Tom are going to take you through later on. But we fabricated it in that heavy industry environment. It was done using Peter and Ben, who are actually here today as well. So you got Ben in the middle, and he was actually operating the kit. And then the final picture is a few of us who were involved in the project once we completed all the welds. Next slide, please. And that concludes the end of my presentation. Has anyone got any questions on what they've heard today so far? Anything from? Nothing at all? Good news, good news. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thanks very much. For those of you who are keeping a close eye on the agenda, you'll realize my, again, very deliberate mistake where I haven't shown the video. I'm gonna show the project video now. So again, that should be hopefully being shared with the guys on the Zoom. So I'm just gonna load that up and we can play that. And then we're going to go on to John's presentation after that.
The aim of the EBManPower project is to provide a solution for the rapid serial manufacture of thick section vessels for the nuclear and other industries. To achieve this, the consortium led by Cammell Laird and including CVE and TWI are investigating low-cost, single-pass electron beam welding of UK. By using existing equipment and the current manufacturing chain, the project will minimise labour and associated costs, and also removes the need for construction of a bespoke EB welding facility. Overall, this means less capital outlay, less maintenance, and with a commercially available electron beam welding machine with no chamber, there is no restriction on the size of pieces to be joined. Testing the technology in an industrial fabrication facility makes it possible to assess the influence of the working environment in full-scale production. Local vacuum electron beam welding can be used to provide near net shape manufacturing at close to the required thickness. There are also no expensive consumables required. Therefore, the final weld composition and properties are similar to the base materials. The joining rate can be up to 90% faster than other welding methods, cutting down on labour and inspection costs, as well as offering much higher productivity. With less post-weld machining and a high level of integrity, the overall performance is superior to other joining methods. EBManPower achieves this by simplifying the manufacturing and qualification processes. Firstly, by cold bending ordinary hot rolled stainless plates to form a cylindrical canister. These canister sections are then longitudinally EB welded, therefore logistically more efficient and less costly than alternative manufacturing routes. Multiple canister sections can then be circumferentially EB welded together to form a complete vessel, with the welding development and qualification being done in a small chamber machine. There is no need to qualify the weld on a full-scale test piece. The final welding machine and operators can then be qualified through non-destructive testing of the demonstration assembly to eliminate the need to extract and destructively test samples from the vessel. EB welding is a code-compliant process. It has been used for the nuclear and aerospace industries for decades. It is highly repeatable and only needs a single trained operator rather than coded welders to conduct the welding process. The welding parameters can be developed off-site by a specialist and transferred to site for production. The challenges addressed included an increased tolerance for EB welding to joint fit-up, leading to further reductions in cost through being able to accept a gap of up to 0.6 millimetres. Local vacuum electron beam welding can be used for a wide range of applications, such as non-nuclear pressure vessels, monopiles for wind turbine foundations and underwater data centres, funded by Innovate UK. This project is being led by Cammell Laird in collaboration with Cambridge Vacuum Engineering and TWI.
Excellent. I will show that video again probably at the end, because I think there might have been some technical issues as we presented that. So it's my pleasure to welcome up John Eldridge, who's going to give us a presentation now.
Great. Okay. Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to be in front of a live audience, actually. And I'm going to take this thing off as well for once. First time in about 18 months to actually be able to talk to people rather than just to a screen, and it's good. So, and I'm also delighted to be here because I was actually involved at Cammell Laird myself way, way back when this was first muted. And things have moved on at a pace, not only within the EBManPower project, but also within the U-Battery. And I thought I'd spend a little bit of time just talking to you how that's progressing. So a little bit of an introduction on the what the U-Battery actually is as a power system. The product that we're trying to produce, and we're deliberately using that name, that phrase, product. We're not building a special one-off reactor, which has been the traditional route all these years. We want to get to the point where we can build these things in multiple units and have a fleet of these. We'll talk about the potential markets. One thing that's been common right through this project and our own is the incredible level of support we've had from our BEIS colleagues. And then what's our approach to design? I might as well tip you off on there. If you fall asleep while I'm talking about the technology, that's great. That's where I want to be. We want to make the technology as boring and as predictable and as proven as possible. So a very key thing there. I'll talk a little bit about what we're actually doing, because we're going at a pace as well. We're about a year behind our completion from the equivalent presentation as this. And we are building. I love building things, I admit that. I never really grew up beyond my Meccano. And in fact, this structure you see here is actually a mock-up. It's one that we're having manufactured as we speak, and that will be available for viewing later on this year. So I'll just push on. So it's, 2009 when this was first started or first muted by the then MD of Urenco. And he put a challenge out to the Manchester and Delft universities, basically saying he wanted to see a small carbon neutral power plant. And basically he could see it delivering either electricity or process heat, and he meant high grade process heat, perhaps both of them, perhaps individually. And he wanted it to a point where it could be placed anywhere. It wasn't restricted to the current sites that are distributed all around the coastline, that it could be in an industrial park. It might be on a science park. It could be somewhere like we've got here. Had to be road transportable. Now, we're not talking about the entire thing, but certainly the module build was a key thing. In other words, we could factory build this unit. Autonomous operations. So in other words, you start it up and you run it for an extended period of time with nobody on it. Just let it operate, delivering power as you need. You'd have remote monitoring, but that might be somebody 100 meters away or 100 kilometers away. And they would probably be operating a fleet of these or monitoring a fleet, very much like your wind farms now. We're looking at rapid refueling. In other words, you take it off the line after an extended period and you get it. You get the old fuel out, get the new fuel in. Now, the idea originally was that you took that out in one and replaced in one. Now, in actual fact, reality's got courses with that one. That doesn't quite work, but the term did, because we were saying take the battery out, put a new battery in, a new battery. And of course, it's got to be economic. It's got to be able to compete. I mentioned the other renewable systems that there are about. So we've got to be able to compete on that. And of course, the one that really jarred a little bit with the universities was the fact that it had to be based on well-established technology. Hence my earlier comment that ideally it's all a bit boring and a bit predictable. So this is the result. After a lot of deliberation, they looked at literally every form of reactor that was, every form of reactor design that was out there, and came up with the HTGR, high temperature gas reactor. 10 megawatts, so it's quite small. And it could deliver, under that design, high-grade heat, process heat at 700 plus. So you're double what you would expect from a water-based reactor. Got a prismatic core, which I can talk about again with you, but basically it's a solid core of graphite. And the fuel in there, there's sufficient fuel in there to run for 5 years. So you run it 5 years, nobody's near it, it's just producing the power for you, either in the form of heat or electricity, if that's what you want. We use helium to cool it. It's what we call a primary circuit. And as I say, there's the graphite core sitting in there. And then we have a heat exchanger, and that heat exchanger then is used to transfer the heat to the power conversion system, whatever that is. And in this case, you can see a gas turbine in there, but there could be a steam turbine on there. It could be just molten salts, or it could be a direct transfer of process heat to your factory. In other words, basically what goes on here is for the customer. And as I say, that medium at the moment, we've got nitrogen in there. We think that might actually move to helium. So we're looking at, it's small, it's factory build. So we're looking at a very rapid construction. So modules and module build, hence the link with Cammell Laird in the early days, hence the interest in what EBManPower was doing. So right at the heart of this is the what we call the TRISO fuel. You can read that as well as me, tristructural isotopic. There's always something quite, I'm just struggling with the technology. But the key about this stuff is that it's absolutely, virtually indestructible. we are not constrained, as we are again with the LWR fuels, by temperature. Essentially, it's a ceramic, and it's virtually indestructible. And you can see the sorts of temperatures. And my zapper isn't working, but we'll go on with that. So it basically retains its structure. If you get any sort of overheating, and we think at a push you will get perhaps something over 1,000 degrees, but at no time can you exceed the destruction point of the fuel. The plant is small, so there's an advantage there. It's got a high thermal capacity. Nothing happens fast with a graphite block. You've got 40 tons of graphite. So nothing happens like that. It's slow, it gives you time to monitor and see things happen. And of course, if something does go wrong, if you find you've got a problem with your coolant system, well, one of the things to do is just leave it. Because as it gets warmer, it actually goes into what we call the negative coefficient. In other words, as it gets hotter, it stops working, it stops fissioning. And basically, it just comes off the curve and starts cooling down on its own volition. It's made out of, say, there's refractory core materials there that are incredibly robust. And as we said before, at the best, you can get to a maximum temperature we would envisage about 1500 degrees C, which is healthily below the damage point of the fuel. So basically, where are we going with this? Well, we keep to small. Small is easy to design. It's easy to design for manufacture. We have an incredibly robust fuel. And I should say there, it's not new. This fuel's been used as a type since the 50s. And in fact, I'm sorry to say, I'm old enough to have worked on the tail end of the very first reactor, the Dragon reactor at Winfrith. I must admit, I was very small. I was probably about that size when I was there. But it's got a long pedigree of nearly 60 years of evolution to the point where reliability is guaranteed. It means that we can demonstrate the safety. Because the system is simple, because it's inherently safe, we don't need to put layer upon layer and layer of safety systems on there. We can then look at a low construction risk. In other words, by being able to factory build fully tested systems, again, very much as they do with as Jamie was showing with the shipbuilding, you know, where you get fully completed modules. In fact, I think I was looking at parts of the aircraft carrier early on, which were built as units at Cammell Laird and then shipped round to the Rosyth to be assembled as fully fitted out systems. Mentioned autonomous operations. And by going small, it also means it gives the customer choice. So he or she can think about whether they want to stay coupled to the grid or whether they want to be independent and obviously make major savings there. And one of the things about this reduction of risk, it reduces the biggest problem we have on new building nuclear, the cost of the money, because the risk is reduced. So I've mentioned already that there's a wide range of potential customers, if you like, and this is just some of them. And in fact, we're almost certain that the big one at the end, the one that we will finally no doubt fix on, is probably not on here. You know, it needs a bit more imagination. But as I said, there's this potential of just delivering heat. And the thoughts of that is it's where you would perhaps deliver heat to a foundation industry. It might be the glass, ceramics, chemicals. One of those industries at the moment that rely on gas heating, which obviously is going to be not available within the next couple of decades. We can talk about a variable one where we go to cogen. You can have the option of switching between electricity and or power or heat, dependent again on the time of the day. And then there's all the other various options of boosted heat, energy storage. I mentioned the molten salts earlier on. You might have a molten salt system there so that you can in fact take, instead of the say 4 megawatts of electric, you could take 8 off it for a spike if you've got a slightly spiky process. And there are others. But in terms of the actual build, if we take the reactor island, that is absolutely the same. You are in Ford territory here. Any color you like, it's going to be that. This is the idea that we build multiples of the same thing. The variable will be here. In other words, what power conversion system do you actually use? And so this is just an indication. It's just expanding on some of the what we consider the initial opportunities. There's certainly hydrogen is very much in the reckoning now. Synthetic fuels for aviation. We know we're starting to see electrically powered aircraft, but certainly long term, long haul, it will be liquid fuels. So, and I've mentioned here about some of the foundation industries there, and perhaps it's worth noting that 10% of the UK emissions are coming from those industries, but they're major contributors to our economy. You know, 52 billion, and of course, a significant number of jobs associated with these, you know, with these products. And of course, simply exporting these jobs, these industries, is not an option. It doesn't do anything for the planet. I mentioned before about our support from BEIS, and in fact, last year was quite an important year for us because we were successful in two areas. We not only were able to extend an existing relationship we had at the same time as the EBManPower was starting off, we were having the AMR feasibility study was launched by BEIS, and we were one of the lucky. I think it was something like 28 companies originally, and eight of us were selected to go to phase one, which we delivered in the end of 2018-19, and we were then selected last year to go into the phase two, along with two others. There were two other technologies. Westinghouse with their lead cooled fast reactor, and there was also the fusion reactor at Cullum. So since about this time last year, we've been working on our phase two, which is the conceptual design. So we're really starting to crank up the level of technology and the engineering, and if you like, confirming that we can actually do this thing in the way that we believe. And you know, it's due for delivery, as I say, next year. But early last year as well, there was another opportunity came our way from the Advanced Manufacturing and Materials program. And we got the opportunity to build a mock-up. Now, we're a bit sort of arsy-facy here. So you think, well, you do your design and then you build the model for it. Well, we didn't have that option. We're building the model, now we're doing the design. But we're sort of okay. It was an opportunity, and I'm delighted that we were given that opportunity. I think for me, we've got to build things. We've got to demonstrate we can be building, and that's precisely what's happening. And in fact, I'll talk a little bit about this later on, because in fact, we're just at the exciting bit of starting to assemble it. So our approach to the design, again, for many involved in the nuclear, historically very complex, very long, very term. We're keeping well clear of that. We want simple, economical. It's got to be reliable. We want these things to run effectively untouched for 5 years, be taken offline for a 4 or 5 week period, refueling, maintenance, monitoring, whatever you need to do, then get off and run it again. We certainly know about safety. The safety has to be built in. It's good design by keeping it simple, by keeping the dependency low. You can read that as well as I can, speed as I can say it. This is an important one, maximizing what we can buy off the shelf. You know, we've mentioned earlier about the technology being, if you like, predictable, boring. If you want to use it, that's deliberate. And that's why certainly the work that's been going on with the EB welding is so important to us. We are watching it and obviously monitoring it with interest. It's got to be well developed by the time it gets to us. We want to, so in other words, we're keeping risk down. There is a tradition in the UK where we often build a first of a kind, a prototype, and it doesn't bear a lot of resemblance to the production unit. Well, we're not doing that. We're trying to keep as close as possible to that. And that's what we're designing at the moment. We mentioned the 5-year refueling cycle. Something that is novel is that you have seen the pictures of the big reactors, the big power plants with these enormous refueling machines parked up there, because multi-million pound systems sitting above the cores. And of course, with the AGRs, it's online refueling that's happening all the time. In our case, it's once every 5 years. So our view is we'll take the fuel refueling kit away. In fact, we'd use it on another plant. In other words, we spread the cost. But that's quite novel in itself. What we're actually doing, how we do it, is different. Is common, but actually removing it is. That's new, and we're having those sorts of conversations with our regulator colleagues. We're designing for 30 years, but we've got in mind that what would happen if your customer would like you to extend. We're keeping that in mind. Well, what would you do? What would you do as part of the design to enable you to do it? But coincidentally, by designing it so it could be extended, actually means you can actually decommission it. Those two tend to get wrapped together. You can decommission it quite readily. And again, unlike what we're having to learn on every single one of our power plants, where everyone is unique, currently, these you again end up with a multiple build, multiple decommission approach. So I mentioned autonomous operations earlier. We would see you'd have people there for the startup. And then you go into a remotely monitored regime. And if necessary, you can do an emergency shutdown from there as well. So a bit busy, this slide, but it actually gives you an idea of just what's happening in a bit more depth in terms of the people. And you can see by that list down the middle, we've got pretty well all the key players involved in the UK nuclear. Jacobs, who used to be the Wood Group, who were AMEC, very, very heavily involved, and in fact have been involved pretty well from the beginning of the concept. Obviously ourselves, Cavendish, Rolls-Royce, who are doing work for us at the moment, they're looking at can we take a standard gas turbine engine, turboshaft engine, it's similar to the ones that are used on the Hercules, could that be converted so it could actually operate directly behind from the U battery? And then, we've got Costains, we're building in civils. And the issue here is we're having to design this from the back to the front. Traditionally, you would design your plant. Then you would look at how you're going to package it. Then you would look how you would make modules from it. And then you'd actually think about the civil requirements. In this case, it's the other way around. We're actually saying, well, in terms of being able to transport anything, what size can we go to? In terms of being able to bring in the civil structures, as much of it as you can by truck, rather than wet pouring, what's the limitations? What limitations does that impose on your process plant? In other words, what envelope have you got to work with? You can't just push your elbows out and just go as big as you need. In this case, you say, well, actually, that's the rectangle. That's the box you've got to work with. So the civil, the modules, the ability to transport dictates how the plant is laid out. We've talked about a lot today and the importance of this, and certainly some fantastic stuff being on show already about from the Cammell Laird setup, from here, from the TWI, from CVE. In terms of the manufacturing and the modularity. Now, again, as I said, we're trying to stay with what is well proven. I keep repeating that. I'll make no bones about that. The challenges we want to be able to put to our colleagues at within the regulators, and that is that we are looking at off-site build, off-site construction, off-site test, install it rapidly, and then do the final hookup tests. We're talking about taking the knowledge or the existing refueling systems away from the plant and bringing them back again. So we're not talking about how we build the plant itself, what we build the plant with, you know, the mechanisms there. We want those as well-proven systems. And again, you see the modularity. Transport fits in there. We're looking for the early results on that. In other words, the transportation, the ability to transport large units, you know, around the UK, it's not just around, by barge. We have to assume we're inland. You know, what are the limitations? Have we got on there? And I'm right at the bottom there, I've put that in. You can see the full-scale mock-up that we're building. So although they're two separate programs, they are funded through two different routes. We're obviously taking as much credit as we can from the work that we've done on here to put it into the main body of the AMR. Probably just one area that's a particular interest to the people in this room is what's happening in work pack one. Up there, this is the reactor primary systems. In other words, this was the stuff contained at the heart of the reactor. So this is the reactor pressure vessel. It's the intermediate heat exchanger. So it's the key pressure boundary systems associated with, if you like, the heart of the system. So, in other words, how are we delivering it? And arguably, this has been the biggest challenge for us, is that top line. There's a nuclear culture, which is a bit slow and a bit steady as you go. It's what you've done many times before, and often it's quite slow. And we've actually put quite a challenge in on that from day one. We wanted to learn from others, from other safety critical areas. And I'm delighted that we've actually been quite successful. This, I just lifted it. This was a quote from one of the people that were named on the slide earlier, one of the major companies there. It was totally unwitty. It was given from one colleague to another. But we've made progress. And you can feel it now that this thing is beginning to motor. We've got just over a year to deliver the conceptual design. We've been hit like everybody else, probably harder than perhaps any of us realized with the COVID thing, the inefficiencies that's actually brought in, inevitably, as we've not been able to do what we're doing here. Just by not being able to meet people in the same room has meant that it's just always been that little bit slower. Always got there, always got a result, but it takes time. And now we're beginning to motor. So, we're talking about keeping it as simple as possible as we can make it, keep the efficiency right. We're looking at offsite manufacture and the module design that leads the design overall. I've talked about autonomy. We have not and will not claim to have all those answers. We're sticking our hands up. You know, we've got some knowledge, but not all the necessary, all the required. And certainly Chris and I and a few others in this room have had a few conversations with me like, how the heck am I going to do this? And I have no qualms about that. We are talking with our regulators and of course, our stakeholders, but our regulators on a regular basis. Again, what we're pleased is they're seeing a very positive approach. We're being very open with what we're trying to do here. We do not hide things. We've got issues. We want to bring them up. We're not here for surprising. So finally, what are we doing now? As I say, I always like to finish off with things we're building. This isn't quite as polished and shiny as your lovely vessel that you've just delivered. But this is the mocker. And what we have effectively is the reactor cavity sitting over there. It's essentially the two big modules that form the heart of the reactor. Reactor pressure vessel there, And this is it sitting at Manchester Precision. This was taken a couple of weeks ago, and you can see it's getting ready. It's just ready. It's completely finished, ready to be brought in. As I said, I've got to confess, it's a facsimile. It's carbon steel, painted, and it weighs about 9 tons, as opposed to the 80 tons that the real thing would be. It's slightly bigger than yours, because by the time we got our numbers crunched, your 2 meters became 2.6 meters for us, because we needed to get more fuel in to guarantee our sort of 5 years or whatever. And we've got, the top flange in there. And this is the heat intermediate heat exchanger, which sits up there. And then here's the cross-vessel duct, which actually hooks the two together. And in a way, that actually almost paid for the rig itself for me, because one of the things is always there. How do you couple? You've got two modules going together, two key vessels sitting in there. How do you hook them together without having to displace one or the other vessels, you know, once you get on site? And that hairpin-shaped cross-vessel duct is a coaxial system. It's actually quite a complex beast. That by taking that hairpin approach, it means that we can install without having to disturb the positioning of these. So this is literally as we speak is being assembled now at Whetston near Leicester, you know, the Cavendish facility. And we're looking for a demonstration to our various stakeholders and certainly our base colleagues, potentially September. That's what we're aiming for at the moment. Dates are still to be confirmed, but it's good stuff. And then, and I think that's probably where I'd like to leave it, Tom, if that's all right. So again, if there's any burning questions, have we got anything? So that's good. So that's good. That means I don't have to answer any hard questions. All right.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, John.
How are
we
doing, Tom?
Okay.
Good. Okay. Thanks for that, John. That's a really good insight into the background to this project, in fact. And so what I'd like to do is describe a little bit more about some of the details that you've seen already. So there's a bit of repetition, but hopefully it'll give a flavour for how we've got to where we are. And you'll be able to see this, the component parts in the car park, I think, later today. First of all, I'd like to sort of offer thanks to everybody who's been involved in this project. And there's a huge number of people, actually, when you look at this list, and from several organisations. And one of the real successes of the project is how well it's been managed and run as a team. And I think that's down to Cammell Laird. What you also notice, some acknowledgements are to do with the work we did on site, and we've acknowledged B&M's Aldi, the M6 Toll, Michael Mosley, the Cheshire Yeoman, Village Hotel in Birkenhead, Bitcoin and PG Tips. And I think all the people involved in the programme will know what that means. So I think the point here really is it was a true collaboration, and it was successful because of that collaboration. So what I'd like to talk about this morning is a little bit of the background. You've heard a bit from Tom already on local vacuum, electron beam and laser welding, what the target objectives were for the programme, and actually the scope of the EBManPower project. And what you notice is that big team of people, we addressed quite a lot of topics. And the key to it really is what was at the start of the project, what we considered was the definition of success. And that was the people we ought to keep mentioning is Innovate UK and the monitoring officer, who also fulfilled a very vital role in all of this as well. One of the things that arose very early in the project was the design of the demonstrator, which, a bit like John said, if we'd designed the demonstrator halfway through the project, it would have been different. And Conrad will vouch for the moving target problems we've had with other demonstrators. We'll talk a little bit about the welding developments at TWI and how that was carried out in a chamber rather than with a local vacuum system. And Tom will he'll talk about that. And then how the equipment was configured and finally installed at Cammell Laird. What you also have to bear in mind is this all happened during a pandemic, which is why Aldi and B&M are quite important. We'll go on to describe a little bit about the demonstrator, how it was manufactured. And what we also should point out is this isn't how we'd expect to make a serially manufactured component. This was done to demonstrate the process rather than being the most economic, cost-effective way of making it. And we always say that qualification is essential in the nuclear industry, so you can't have a structure put into service without the regulatory body approving it. There's also other areas we've looked at, and there's been a business case analysis that Cammell Laird have carried out into other applications where, if you were lucky enough to install one of these systems on your site, you'd have loads of other things to do with it. So a little bit about local vacuum EB and laser welding. What's the point is the first question. And I think we understand that the type of structure where you can apply electron beam welding, heavy section electron beam welding, by definition tend to be quite large. The process is widely used in making turbochargers and gas turbine compressor drums, but actually the process isn't used very much for making very big structures. And the reason for that is traditionally you have to carry out the welding inside a vacuum chamber. And if you build a 120 meter long vacuum chamber, first of all, you end up with a big electricity bill to pump it, but also it's a big structure. So these are some of the potential applications, like pressure vessels and offshore wind structures. But the benefits really come in thick section welding because it's a single pass welding process. And here you see a multi-pass submerged arc weld on the left-hand side in 100 millimeter thick carbon manganese steel. In contrast, you see a single pass electron beam weld. And if you're very good at counting, you'll notice there's about 70 weld passes in the submerged arc weld. And each one of those takes about the same amount of time as it takes to make the electron beam weld. So you make the electron beam weld with no filler wire, so there's no consumable, there's no flux, there's no gas. And the fusion zone profile is such that it's parallel and quite narrow. So when there's any shrinkage, that tends to be perpendicular to the weld and uniform, and there's very little out-of-plane bending. You also end up with a situation where the maximum residual stresses, the tensile residual stresses, are buried in the center of the weld rather than at the outside, which can be a benefit. What you also see in this image is a single pass laser weld. So every time we show this picture, that laser weld gets bigger. So ultimately, a few years' time, that'll be. What we should point out, though, is that is a atmospheric pressure laser weld. And if you reduce the pressure, as Tom was describing, in laser welding, you double the penetration depth. So laser welding is something worth keeping an eye on. So we've mentioned the issues with welding in a vacuum chamber. It's a very good way to provide an atmosphere and a protective environment, but it constrains the size of component you can weld. So in this structure, you see it's got a big vacuum chamber. This is welding a submarine component in very high accuracy requirements and in a high strength steel. The chamber in this case takes about 3 hours to get to vacuum. And the contrast you'll see is with the local vacuum process, you don't need to wait before you start welding. Hopefully this works. We've seen this image already, I think. And what this shows is the electron beam in air. And so for many years, this is going back to the 1970s when this started, that people were trying to use the electron beam in directly into air without a vacuum chamber at all. And actually this worked quite well up to a certain penetration depth. And this was made possible, and this is a TWI version, this is a 30 kilowatt electron beam in a helium overpressure stage. And what we have is a lot of scattering of the electron beam. So if you try and increase the power, you just make the welds wider. But what this, what these set of experiments and research did was allowed for a gun design, which would mean that the beam could be transmitted from a high vacuum envelope in the electron gun into the air at atmospheric pressure. And this was achieved by differential pumping through a series of small nozzles. And in turn, that was made possible by the design of a diode type electron gun, which didn't suffer from a different focus position at different power levels. And that meant the beam would go through these small nozzles quite readily. So that was the real step that took us to this position. And it was later discovered that if you reduce the pressure in the vicinity of the beam quality improved. So in this case, you see, I don't know if anyone's been to the top of Mount Everest, but it's 350 millibar pressure there, and you can still breathe, not very well, but it's hard to call it a vacuum. So we call it a reduced pressure. And if you fly across the Atlantic, actually in Concorde, you get to about 60 millibar pressure. And the beam here you see at 5 millibar is now intense, parallel, and without a defined focus position. So that gives you a few other practical process advantages. And this shows the beam in a chamber being used to weld a very thick section component. So the real benefit is that by working at this higher pressure than is typical for electron beam welding systems, you can weld using just a localized vacuum. So you know, generate a vacuum local to the part. So you don't need a chamber that the whole structure fits inside. And this is an artist's impression, which combines a power supply, pumping system, and a variety of other things. But it was an artist that drew it rather than an electron beam welding engineer. The next step then was to show that this was actually possible. And this is an experiment done to show that you could have a local sliding vacuum head whilst maintaining a reasonable vacuum pressure for welding in. And this is just for scale, that's a 50 millimeter thick duplex stainless steel plate. And the head speed is designed for the welding speed. So it's going about 200 millimeters a minute. And this illustrated that you could, in this case, maintain a vacuum pressure of about 1 millibar. Whilst sliding across the metal surface and making a weld. And you can see the weld bead on the cap. So that was then translated to a project looking at welding of tubular structures, and using a laboratory prototype welding head, it was shown that you could weld, in this case, a 1.7 meter long, 60 millimeter thick carbon manganese steel vessel. The key thing here is it took 6 minutes, and that includes the pumping time. So you switch the machine on, start welding, 6 minutes later you've welded 1.7 meters of 60 millimeter thick material without any preheats, without any wire flux or gas. And increasing the wall thickness of the tubular to 80 millimeters results in exactly the same joint completion rate. So you can weld at the same speed with a bit more power. And you also notice there's very little in the way of material preparation. This has still got the mill scale on from the rolling. So at that point, Cambridge Vacuum Engineering commercialized the system, which became Ebflow, which is what we're talking about today. And this shows the local vacuum system designed for linear welding in an X-ray enclosure. So the idea is that whilst you don't need a chamber, you do need to protect your operator from X-rays. So this is a lead box, which you operate the system in. And more recently, this has now been developed for the laser process. So you can hear some local vacuum laser welding head. And the benefit here is you don't need any X-ray protection, and you also don't need any, you don't need to be concerned about residual magnetism. So they're two positive things about working with a laser. But traditionally lasers, and I think currently lasers are a bit behind on the power generation side of things. It's more difficult to make a 100 kilowatt laser than it is an electron beam system. So it's not clear where the laser fits in, apart from you can have your beam delivery system about 100 meters away from the beam generator. So that gives you the option to make very big structures again. So moving on to the EBManPower project. So I think we know a bit about the objectives and what tasks were carried out from some previous, from the presentations you've heard already. One of the key things is to show the machine equivalency. So one of the things we did was developed all the welding process details in a chamber. And we then wanted to show that we could repeat those with a local vacuum to the satisfaction of the ASME code. And that involves making a demonstrator. And the demonstrator was John's design. And as he said, it's changed since then. So this could be, the local brewery is quite interested in this, actually, stainless steel pressure vessel. But the idea was to demonstrate using a generically similar part to the U battery components. And in this case, the demonstrator was 2 meters diameter and 3-4 meters long, with two longitudinal seams in it and a dished end and a flange welded on the other end. The aim, and we've mentioned Pete and Ben who are in this photograph, is to qualify the welding procedures at TWI in a chamber machine, but then to qualify the welding machine and the operators by welding this demonstration component. And there were the two types of weld. One was the longitudinal seams, which were 60 millimeters thick, 1.5 meters long, and these are welded in the horizontal vertical or 2G position. This time it was in 304 grade stainless steel, which I believe might have changed since then. And the second thing was to make fully penetrating welds in the 3G position, which is vertical up, by rotating the component in front of a fixed head. And in both cases, to qualify those procedures to ASME Section 9 boiler and pressure vessel code. And in that way, it was possible to qualify the machine, the weld procedure, and the operators in one task. So at the start of the project, we had a big meeting and decided what could possibly go wrong, which took about 3 days. And the first one was about, is this material weldable? Which we kind of knew it probably was, but there are issues about nitrogen contents and things like that. The biggest question was, would we ever be able to achieve the fit up you need to weld the components in the shipyard environment that Jamie's explained? And whether we can get the necessary cleanliness, the assembly and reliability and consistency of the process. So these are all worries. And actually, as it turned out, though, the least worry, the things that we predicted would be difficult turned out not to be. There's a few other things there, but the key thing was to get acceptance by the regulator and finally to get the customer or several customers to recognise it as a process worth continuing. And so the definition of success was to get all of these things which we've mentioned. And the key thing is it has to be safe. You want a welding process which doesn't cause any risk or safety issues with the workforce. But what it does do is eliminate some of the other risk areas that you get from welding. So there's no welding fume. You notice the inside of the biological shield is painted white, and you think, what's the worst colour you could paint a welding bay? And actually why it's good, because it stayed very clean for the past 3 years. There's no slag, so you don't have to chip slag off, which is a good thing. There's no, I'll say, very little grinding. That's, we can talk about that later. So there's lots of things that we thought we ought to look at for the what was the definition of success. The main thing was achieving quality of welds and reliability. But again, I should emphasize that it was a very successful collaboration. All the people involved worked seamlessly. So what I'd like to do now is pass you on to Tom, who's going to talk a little bit about the process qualification aspect. I'll
do that. Thanks very much, Chris. So, as Chris was highlighting, one of the key reasons behind qualifying in-chamber rather than the kind of system that was up at Cammell Laird was really due to kind of cost. Because if you can take smaller coupons, not quite kind of liftable coupons, but smaller size coupons, qualify the weld procedure, demonstrate that you've got a robust procedure, John's going to be really happy if it's really boring and dull. But if we can do that and produce it on the small coupons, then showcase that it can be done on a larger kind of component. And again, that just makes life so much easier. So one of the things we had to do was obviously do the development work, as Chris said, on that 60 millimeters kind of stainless steel, and then do the suitable inspection to check the quality of the welding, and then ensure that the procedures we developed, the parameters, all transferred across. And again, I think in Chris's presentation in a bit, he showcases the similarities between each of the EB systems and how we were actually able to transfer parameters from an in-chamber machine onto the system up at Cammell Laird. So in terms of what we're doing, we have a CVE machine here at TWI. The chamber on that's 3 meters by 3 meters by 4 meters. And you can see the setup we had in the middle slide there, the two technicians working. That was pre-COVID times, hence why they're merrily not wearing masks and working quite closely to one another. But the key thing again was actually looking at the materials. So as Chris talked about, the vessel itself was 304H, and we did work on 304H, but equally, we saw what happens if we went to the L variant of 304 rather than the H variant. And actually, okay, you've got the difference in the composition that you can see in terms of the reduced silicon in particular being kind of the big difference on, I guess, the kind of carbon content. But actually, we were able to weld both the L and the H using exactly the same parameters. The other thing Chris talked about was the kind of high-low and the mismatch. And again, because we're rolling a kind of a shell together to make a can, we weren't guaranteed we would have no gap. That would be what I would love as an EB kind of welder, would to have zero gap. So we had to then do a little bit of trials and say, well, can we accommodate a larger gap? And actually what we were able to do was to qualify a weld with exactly the same parameters if we had the perfect butt joint and if we had a 0.6 mil gap all the way along. So that was a worst case scenario, because if it's a 0.6 mil gap all the way along, you just close it up. But I wanted to deliberately push the technology, push the parameters and say, what's worst case? Because then again, when we kind of pass the kind of parameters on, we can say, look, we've got real confidence. We've tried this in a really robust way. So again, we then worked with Lloyd's Register. You can see on the far left of the screen there, they stamped their kind of text all over it to make sure that actually, as we went through the qualification process, we didn't slyly just swap out their material that we welded, put some perfectly kind of welded material. We wanted to make sure that, as I say, the whole time we're maintaining that traceability. And so you can see the UT image, ultrasonic kind of image there on the bottom left to say, actually, that weld was really good. And we were able to then qualify that weld. And you can see there the kind of 2G pack we got from Lloyd's Register, and then seamlessly take that up to Cammell Laird. And then on the far right, you can see the weld that was produced in the 2G. So that's the kind of horizontal weld from effectively kind of left to right. So we did the same thing on the 3G. So this is the vertical up that Chris was talking about. Again, with this one, there was a little bit more of a challenge. We only had parameters that were suitable for no gap. We again tried to see if it could be a bit more robust with a kind of larger gap in there. But unfortunately, the kind of welding didn't kind of work with a larger gap between it. And so we equally did some work on the slope out. Again, we got some good results, effectively produced a slope out that was kind of suitable, where you can see again, we're getting those positive results. And I guess most importantly, we didn't see any defects in that weld when we x-rayed it. But as we have to admit, slope out is one of the more tricky, challenging aspects of kind of welding, particularly EB welding. And as is put on the slide there, there is a kind of knife edge or a kind of cliff edge as to kind of any changes in the kind of EB gun at all. So one of the other things we did, again, to help with the process transfer, was to create a coupon that could fit on the reduced pressure gun. So this was, you can see, within that 2 meter diameter, we had smaller coupons, again, really just from taking the process through its kind of industrialization. In reality, we've demonstrated that the parameters you use on a small coupon can go straight up into the component itself. But in this project, we wanted to take a kind of step slowly through it. So that was something else we did. And then again, you can see the kind of weld that we produced in chamber on the CVE machine, again, using effectively a diode gun that Chris has talked about, got that qualified by Lloyd's Register, and then again, transferred that up to Cammell Laird with CVE. And you can see the 3G weld on the vessel itself there on the far right hand side. So as part of all of that qualification, we obviously had to get all the documentation certification together. And my colleague Ricky is brilliant actually at making sure that we had all of the documentation ready, so that when the Lloyd's Register guy came, he literally had a portfolio with every single bit of documentation, whether that be the mill cert, whether it be the preliminary weld procedure we've got, or the inspection reports. That was all there and documented. And again, that's critical to have all of that information, all of that history, so that when Lloyd's Register came to qualify the weld, they had the documentation that they needed. So that kind of summarizes what we did in terms of within the project. This is now a little bit of a sales pitch, so apologies for that. But one of the things to note is at the moment, we've obviously got the process qualified by ASME, it's recognized. However, there are obviously other kind of coding bodies, other qualification. And so one of the things that we're doing now is starting up effectively a joint industry project. So this is looking at trying to compile even more of this data, more of this information for different applications, different materials. And my colleague Ricky Wong is heading that up. And so if you've got any interest in that, you'd be, you know, want to ask questions, again, you've got his contact details there on the slide. But that covers everything I wanted to say, Chris, so I can pass back over to you to continue talking about the EB Manpower project.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Tom. Conscious it's nearly lunchtime, so I'll try and accelerate. So this is really about the history of what happened from the after the design was complete for the demonstrator, what happened next. And Cammell Laird identified a shed, is that the right word? A large building with a floor space. And this is what it looked like when it was identified. So there had to be a little bit of dressing of the floor for the x-ray shield, so routing out some grooves. And then the lead room was constructed. So this, again, it's painted white inside, which is not what you'd want in a welding bay, but it's still the same color. And the machine was installed. So what you see here is a linear traverse and a set of rollers, rotators. And what this would allow you to do is linear welding on the long seams and circumferential welding on the rotating component. And after a huge amount of effort from Cambridge Vacuum Engineering, there was the final commissioning day. And this is, I think probably everybody in the room is in this somewhere. But this is when the machine was finally set up and commissioned. And we've also noted, this is apologies to the Cammell Laird, but it was a shipyard and the roof leaked and there were pigeons and a whole bunch of other things, which meant this was a real industrial environment. And we have a test when we're looking at environments or welding, and it's to do, if you drop a sandwich, would you eat it? And regretfully at Cammell Laird, the answer is probably no, because the pigeons would probably get it first. So it did, the roof leaked a bit and there were a few issues, but actually it showed it the process was sufficiently robust to be operated in that environment reliably with no major issues, really. And that was the great takeaway. So this is a demonstrator. As we said, it's two longitudinally welded cans with dished ends and a flange at the other end. They were initially manufactured at the angle ring company, so they were rolled into the cylindrical shape. And then the edges were subsequently machined. So again, this is a thing that we need to look at, but what the method of working was that you roll the can, jack it open a little bit, machine the edge prep, and then let it spring back to sort of close fitting joint. And they were then delivered to Cammell Laird. And again, you see it is an industrial environment. It's not a laboratory. And offloaded, ready for assembly and welding. When they arrived, they had a 40 millimeter gap, unrestrained, but actually, as it turned out, it was very easy to close the gap up. And you see there's a bit of a high-low mismatch, but with a bit of adjustment using a hydraulic jack, it's possible to get the fit up right. So 0.3 millimeter gap and 0.3 millimeter high-low. So that actually was much, much better than we anticipated. And actually the weld procedure, as Tom said, is qualified to 0.6 of a millimeter gap. It doesn't sound like very much, but it was quite an achievement to get that. So the offset was adjusted with a hydraulic jack. The fit up was achieved using ratchet clamps, straps. And the test to show the fit up, this is a 0.2 millimeter feeler gauge. And I was always very sensitive about how clean the feeler gauges were, but I think it's just rust. So what we then do is seal the joint line with a piece of tape. And that, again, for the electron beam welders who know, sticky tape is not a good thing to put in a high vacuum chamber. But in the local vacuum, reduced pressure environment, sticky tape works quite well. And then the backing box is fitted. So this provides a backing vacuum or reduced pressure at the back. And these run on, run off tabs allow you to weld the component to the end. So in order to help the inspection people, we put some little circles on. So these are about 12 millimeters diameter, I think. And what that allows you to do is track the joint, so you know where the joint is after you've welded it for the ultrasonic inspector. And that gives you a little witness mark, and this shows you the weld bead. It also gives you an opportunity to adjust the focus to exactly the right figure, and that gives you this opportunity to transfer the beam parameters to from the in-chamber qualifications. So this is the first weld completed. And again, the takeaway here is it takes 8 minutes and it's 60 millimeter thick, 1.5 meters long, austenitic stainless steel. So its productivity is fantastic, but the preparation time to get to that point is quite involved. So the challenge is to get the preparation time down to a minimum and the welding takes care of itself. So this is the first complete can. What we did have was a minor fault. So at the start of the welding operation, we got a very small misjoint or lack of penetration defect. So this is the run on, run off tab. This is the stainless steel tab, which gets machined off. And this is the start. This is the stop area. So we stop at the end and that just gets machined away. But we had a little defect here, which was detected by, first of all, visually, so you can see it, but also, but what we showed, we were able to excavate and do a local TIG repair. As it turned out, most of this gets machined away in the edge prep. Then the Lloyd's Register surveyor, Duncan Swinson, came along and put his stamp mark on. And so we did illustrate that Lloyd's Register surveyors do need a bit of practice stamping, because of the stamps flying all over the place. So he's approved that. So again, it approves the weld procedure, the machine and the operator in one fell swoop. So the equipment we used was the 1EB chamber at TWI for the initial qualification. The Cammell Laird machine, which is called 826, is a local vacuum machine, and also some development tests on Steve's machine at Cambridge Vacuum Engineering to check the weld parameters. So actually all of these are equipped with exactly the same electron gun, but arranged in a different geometry. So the challenge was to convince ASME that you could get away with doing weld procedure qualification on a machine 200 miles away from where it's actually going to be carried out, with a slightly different gun to work distance and different focus parameters. So we put that forward to ASME and said, this clause here, I don't expect to read it all, but QW409.6 needs changing because it doesn't reflect the modern world and it doesn't reflect on what the industry ought to do. So we put that forward as a code case or a discussion at Code Week, and that's gone out to vote. And so far there's been 13 positive responses and one negative. So we need to find out the reason behind the negative response or introduce ourselves differently. So this is going through, and I don't think there's any reason why it shouldn't be adopted. And what that'll make easier in the future is we can use this qualification method for different geometries of system. So this is the Lloyd's Register witnessing the welding operation. So he looked at all the parameters as a trend chart. So you can go back and look at what happened during the weld. And this is all pretty vital from a nuclear perspective, that you can say that vessel was welded by this chap with this trend graph, and all that is digitally recorded for posterity. So in 60 years' time, you say, there you go. If you've got the right sort of hard drive. So then after welding, the next step was to do just a shop tool ultrasonic inspection. So we got Neil Dodsworth came along with his phased array ultrasonic test equipment and showed that he found the lack of fusion flaw, which we subsequently repaired. And they also showed the rest of the weld was flaw free. And this is based on side drilled holes. And there's another block with a introduced spark machined root floor as well. So they then, after welding, they went back to angle ring to be re-rolled. So again, not sure that was an essential step, but we wanted them to be as round as possible. And when you do the initial rolling, you put a little, they call it flanging. They put a little bend in it, so you get a flat. We could have dealt with that, but we'd rather start with a nice round thing. And then our friends at Metalcraft, in the middle of COVID, machined the parts, and they then clocked them up to get them to be fit as well as possible with the ends machined flat and parallel to each other. The parts then went back to Cammell Laird, and our TWI's ultrasonic operator then did a time of flight test to qualify the weld procedure finally. So this is what's been submitted to Lloyd's Register. This shows, if you're familiar with time of flight, a grey area with no little horseshoes in it means it's good. These are little bits he's missed, so he goes back and has to do those again. But the consensus was it met the minimum requirements of ASME and actually exceeded them by a long way. Tom's already mentioned that the next step was to show that we could use the exactly the same welding parameters, but with a different machine at Cammell Laird with a local vacuum system. And this shows that we could repeat the vertical up 3G position weld on this insert. This actually was a really good idea at the time and had a few issues as time went on to do with making this seal in the hole. And we can talk about that over lunch. Makes you cringe, some of it. But what it showed is this is actually quite a good way of developing local welding conditions with we call it a letterbox jig. It's a sort of insert jig where you just put your test plate and make a short weld. The parts were then set up, welding some U-section clamps on the inside, fitted with a beam stopper, because obviously you don't want the beam to go right the way through the other side of the canister, ideally. And there's an end stop to stop the canister moving sideways on the traverse, which, when you've got a 2 meter diameter, 1 millimeter thread, it's a very powerful thing to stop. And this shows the first, so we put the same tape on for taping the seam. This shows the first circumferential weld. And what you can also see here is there's a series of short tack welds followed by a full circumferential tack. All of these may be unnecessary but we did that for security. And then followed by the full current weld, which you'll see a piece of when you see it out in the car park. This was again witnessed by our friend from Lloyd's Register, and he again checked the parameters. We've got a digital documentation package which goes with the component everywhere it goes. Then the opportunity to weld the dished end and the carbon steel flange. So the carbon steel flange is welded to a stainless steel insert ring because we didn't want to buy a stainless steel flange for cost reasons. And finally, this is another taped seam, and this is a finished circ seam. The flange has been welded on, we're just doing the dished end, and there's a happy band of brothers. And actually, one of the most useful things we had was this wooden block. If you've got arthritic knees, getting on and off there without the wooden block was quite tricky. And then that's it complete. So that's the end of the campaign. So that's now been shipped here. So one of the big questions is it worth it? Economically, is it a good thing to do? And we've looked long and hard at this. Jamie's done a significant amount of work on the analysis, which we're not presenting here because it's probably not the time. But if you want to make, so as John said, they may want to make 30 vessels a year, could be more than that, and it could be that John wants to make 30 and somebody else wants to make another 30 and another AMR manufacturer wants to make some more. And it's that suddenly you've got a factory which you want to produce 100 vessels a year from. And that's, with arc welding, that's, you start to realise what the production limiting steps are, and making hundreds of weld passes and intermediate grinding, machining and inspection is where the bottlenecks are. So it's not just about wire and flux, it's to do with energy as well. The energy saving is considerable, especially if you take preheat off. I mean, you don't preheat, often if it's stainless steel, but that's something that is an issue. The fume thing is becoming quite an issue at the moment. So welding fume has got a few toxicity issues. So this is actually a fumeless process. The dimensional accuracy, we believe we can get closer to near net shape with less machining. The traceability, so it's a digital welding process effectively. There is no manual intervention. So if you record all of those parameters, providing you've measured your beam, which is something else that's been looked at, then you've got a complete digital record of what parameters are used to make the weld. And you can inspect it immediately after welding. You can actually put your hand on the canister. And I think we've all got burns on our palms to prove that. So, but yeah, immediate inspection is one of the benefits. So one of the things we're talking to ASME about is whether, because there's no hydrogen in the process, whether it's appropriate to eliminate the delayed inspection out of the requirements. DNV asked the same question. We've shown there is a repair strategy, so dig and tick, which is, so every electron beam welder you buy comes with a free tick set. So there are other opportunities. So exploitation in the hydrogen transportation business, with the pressure vessel from Riva Calzone, offshore wind monopile foundation, a reactor pressure vessel, massive bronze propeller, which I'm not sure if that's an ideal application for local vacuum EB, but it's quite big. And there's a hydrogen storage tank in Japan. So this is a cryogenic hydrogen storage tank. there's some new developments. So CVE is developing a local vacuum linear welder, which doesn't need X-ray shields. So all the X-ray shielding is Conrad's designed this fantastic system where you don't need to have a box, you just have it locally shielded. So it means these guys can operate the system quite happily in a 120 meter long tube. I have an image of your machine. Can I share that? No? Okay. So there are some other projects which are happening, and there's some areas where new developments are making the process more reliable, making the equipment more reliable, and dealing with some of the X-ray issues. So I think I'll like to stop there, and if there's any questions, very happy to answer them. Easy ones. If there are any difficult questions, we'll pass you over to John and Jamie.
I've got a couple of questions from the online attendees, so I'll bring them across so that you can.
So are you battery planning to use an EB process to manufacture your primary vessel?
So you use the mic, John, to answer that.
Yeah, it's down to what the TRL will be when we get there. If you think we are looking to manufacture within the next few years, it's, you know, I emphasise the business of COTS. I'm pretty certain it will be part of it, whether it will be on first of a kind or into our nth of a kind. Let's just see how it goes. We're perhaps a bit further on than most of us thought, but I think we talked about some of our colleagues at Sheffield Forge Masters and others. It's going to be really that joint effort. You know, what is the TRL?
Okay. What is the TRL?
So we talk about technology readiness levels. I'm asking the question, is the TRL that we could claim on this, you know, this process at this stage? You know, and I'm looking at perhaps 4, perhaps 5, but certainly for a U battery application as the first of a kind, it'd have to be higher than that.
Yeah, well, I think it's the definition, I believe, if it's it's demonstrated on the application in its correct environment and achieves the minimum requirements, it's probably TRL 5, that right? But I'll look at my colleagues for support that. TRL 5 or 6. And I think very, with the regulators, the key is the regulator is happy with it. And I think if you talk to people in different industries, they're quite happy to go ahead at TRL 6 because they haven't got the time to do multiple repeats.
Yeah, I mean, it's like everything, you know, the nuclear industry is exactly the same as all the others. It's evidence-based. Mm. And, you know, obviously, it's been a major step and no way will I knock that back. As I say, we do not want to go in for any long discussions about the technology that we're using to build this thing. Mm. It's very much the approach and how we're building this. As I say, I find this incredibly encouraging, and I can certainly see it being used. As I say, it's whether it will be first of a kind or as we're into the nth of a kind.
Okay, thanks, John. So the other question is, what is the effect on density of welding with a gap? I think the answer to that is that it doesn't change the density, but it changes the weld reinforcement that you get at the cap and the root, which you need to compensate for. With the gap that we've shown, 0.6 of a millimetre, it can readily accommodate that. We believe you can accommodate a bigger gap, and you could have a system which introduced a wire into the weld pool, which has been demonstrated in several areas.
Alternatively, you could have different, effectively, weld procedure if you've got a different gap. But we wanted, the exam question we set ourselves was, using the same parameter set, what was the largest gap we could accommodate? That's the other alternative. You could have an array and say, well, if my vessel, when I bring it together, I get a 0.7 millimeter joint gap, do I need to use weld procedure for 0.7 to a 1 mil joint gap, let's say. And as Chris said, you could also introduce wires and other things as well. But yeah, that's certainly how I would kind of consider that.
So another question is, does the sticky tape get melted during welding? I guess with a 0.6 millimeter gap, there is quite some space for air ingress. If so, any problem of contamination? So the sticky tape gets completely destroyed during welding. It turns into its sort of constituent parts and gets pumped away. But I don't think we've ever seen any contamination of the tape that tape causes on the weld quality. We have some ideas to get rid of the tape, but it actually works really well currently. And another question is about any loss of nitrogen, loss of austenite content in weld metal that might be of concern. You do lose nitrogen, and I think we were starting with 0.08%. So you probably lose about 100 ppm during welding, maybe a little bit more, which may be a concern if you're worried about austenite stability. One solution is you buy steel with more in to start with. Okay, I think that's all the questions on here. Are there any other questions?
If you click on the Q&A, see if there's any more questions.
Have a quick look.
Glasses on.
Yeah, so there's a question of what are the next steps for process qualification?
I think we've done it.
Yeah, I was going to say it's basically it. Lloyd's register.
It remains as discussions we had with ASME Boiler and Pressure Vessel Code about this process generally, and there's a few missing ingredients, and they warmly recognise that the code needs to be updated to look at new processes and developments. So there's things that have been in the code a long time, which are no longer relevant to laser or EB, especially with local vacuum. So there's a job still to be done with that ASME. It's a comment from Lyle Spiegel. It's what are the requirements of post-weld heat treatment, since this is typical for arc welding of pressure vessels? Not entirely sure whether you heat treat austenitic stainless steel, but you may stress relieve it after welding. But for more traditional pressure vessel materials, you just use the same or slightly modified procedures as you would for an arc welded joint. Again, there's more research to be done on that. And please explain detail about the backing strip. How is it retained and how is it removed? The backing, in this case, there wasn't a backing strip. It was just a backing bar, which is some distance away from the weld joint, which allows the beam to be absorbed without going through the back of the local vacuum box. So there didn't need to be a backing bar removed, backing strip. And is the weld procedure qualified to EN standards? This one wasn't, but it readily could be. The tests are very similar. I'm sure it would be if we did it again. I don't know if there's an equivalency. Can you just say ASME's okay, so Ian ticks the box? Don't know. We can find out. We'll let you know about that.
So I think that's all the questions on Zoom. Is there anything in the room question-wise? What I can try and do is just play that video again, because I was well aware that I think there were one or two technical issues with it. So hopefully I'm just going to get that up again.
The aim of the EB Manpower project is to provide a solution for the rapid serial manufacture of thick section vessels for the nuclear and other industries. To achieve this, a consortium led by Cammell Laird and including CVE and TWI are investigating low-cost, single-pass electron beam welding of 60mm thick stainless steel. This will be performed in a local vacuum, as opposed to a vacuum chamber, using the consortium's existing logistical and manufacturing capabilities here in the UK. By using existing equipment and the current manufacturing chain, the project will minimise labour and associated costs, and also removes the need for construction of a bespoke EB welding facility. Overall, this means less capital outlay, less maintenance, and with a commercially available electron beam welding machine with no chamber, there is no restriction on the size of pieces to be joined. Testing the technology in an industrial fabrication facility makes it possible to assess the influence of the working environment in full-scale production. Local vacuum electron beam welding can be used to provide near net shape manufacturing at close to the required thickness. There are also no expensive consumables required. Therefore, the final weld composition and properties are similar to the base materials. The joining rate can be up to 90% faster than other welding methods, cutting down on labour and inspection costs, as well as offering much higher productivity. With less post-weld machining and a high level of integrity, the overall performance is superior to other joining methods. EBManPower achieves this by simplifying the manufacturing and qualification processes. Firstly, by cold bending ordinary hot rolled stainless plates to form a cylindrical canister. These canister sections are then longitudinally EB welded, therefore logistically more efficient and less costly than alternative manufacturing routes. Multiple canister sections can then be circumferentially EB welded together to form a complete vessel, with the welding development and qualification being done in a small chamber machine. There is no need to qualify the weld on a full-scale test piece. The final welding machine and operators can then be qualified through non-destructive testing of the demonstration assembly to eliminate the need to extract and destructively test samples from the vessel. EB welding is a code-compliant process. It has been used for the nuclear and aerospace industries for decades. It is highly repeatable and only needs a single trained operator rather than coded welders to conduct the welding process. The welding parameters can be developed off-site by a specialist and transferred to site for production. The challenges addressed included an increased tolerance for EB welding to joint fit-up, leading to further reductions in cost through being able to accept a gap of up to 0.6 millimetres. Local vacuum electron beam welding can be used for a wide range of applications, such as non-nuclear pressure vessels, monopiles for wind turbine foundations and underwater data centres, funded by Innovate UK. This project is being led by Cammell Laird in collaboration with Cambridge Vacuum Engineering and TWI.